Okay, all right. Welcome to the College of Complexes, everybody. My name's Don, and I'm going to be the moderator for the evening. Our program tonight is going to be a very special treat. Black America, asking ourselves the tough questions. Our speaker is Sonja Cassandra Perdue, the founder of Chicago's Black Business Network, and she's going to be discussing her book, which is a formalized 5-part Q&A session that begins July 2010 and ends with the last publication in 2014. This series of books will challenge Black America to collectively engage in a dialogue that will initiate solutions to our collective concerns and issues, armed with the knowledge that we are without limitations in spirit or mind, we march forward together to fulfill the hopes and dreams of our people. If there are no more announcements, then let's have a warm round of applause for our speaker tonight, Sonja Cassandra Perdue.
I'm so excited. Do I need to come back here or stand right here?
No, you can come around here. Come to the podium. That way you can people can with our microphone here. We have an invisible microphone.
Because I swore you said it didn't work. But okay.
Well, I'm gonna show up with it.
Testing 1, 2, 3. I'll go along with it. We're here to enjoy, aren't we, people?
Yes.
Seriously enjoy. I hear that you have food fights. I'm Sonja Cassandra Perdue. Thank you so much, Charles, and everyone, my friends, old friends, new friends. My book is Black America, Asking Ourselves the Tough Questions, book 1, 2010. In this announcement, it said my fifth book was supposed to be out by 2014. You know I'm way behind.
You ready?
I've been busy for 4 years. I'm still working on number 2. Let me tell you a little bit about what the book is. It is a dialogue. It's supposed to be a dialogue with Black America. It's the type of conversations that we have in the coffee shops, that everyone has in the coffee shop, discussing their concerns, their issues, their loves, and their dislikes. I'll just simply formalize the process. I'll tell you how it came about. It was never intentional. You know, everybody wants to write a book. I dream about it. I'm writing a book. I started 50. They like a paragraph and a half each. And I haven't finished any. So that the day that this book was produced, it was not my goal to write a book. What actually happened, I was sitting at home upstairs, had a bare little fuzzy white bathrobe on and some fuzzy white shoes. And it was real gray outside. It was sunny outside, but it felt real gray in the room. I felt maybe I've had the blues. You know, it was just kind of a gray day. So I need to make some changes. I need to do something. Something needs to happen. I need to have a talk with myself. Went downstairs to the kitchen to make some tea. I'm going to have a conversation with Sonja. That's how it started. Sit down at the dining room table, and somewhere in between that conversation with Sonja, I said, I have to ask myself some tough questions. And between that, all of a sudden, it became a book. Just pretty much the way it is. I say, the title came, the first question. So I'm going to ask Black America some tough questions. Everybody needs to ask themselves some tough questions. That's where it came from. I sit right there, Black America, asking ourselves the tough questions. And that morning, I wrote this book. The questions are in the order that they flow from me. I removed some and put everything else at the end, except the last one, which asked, when will we overcome, or can we overcome? Shall we overcome? Have I even read my own book? I have. But anyway, shall we overcome someday? That's the last question. But they're actually in the order that they flow from me. This first question in this book, I sit down after I thought of the title, and that's what I was going to do, write a book. It's pretty much exactly how it came out of me that day. Okay? With maybe tiny editing. I'm going to read this first question, although it is not maybe one of the questions that I'm asking, or maybe one of the questions you feel like it pertains to you. I'm quite aware this is not an African-American audience, so I have selected some questions that pertains to all of us. This does as well. It has to be how you interpret it, okay? It's how I interpret living in America. Question number one, Imagine you are a black man in the year is 1955. You're walking down the street in a community known as Bridgeport in Chicago, and four white men pull up beside you in a Chevy. Are you afraid? The year is 1964, and you are a young black man driving down a dark road on your way to Meridian, Mississippi, with two Jewish associates. When you see the bright lights of a car in your rearview mirror, then you see a flashing red light and know that it is a police vehicle. Do you feel safe, or are you forever regretful? As a black man in the year 2010, which is the year of the book, you're driving through Chicago's Inglewood community and you quite appropriately stop at a stop sign. Before you can pull off, four black men pull up next to you in a car. Are you scared? Where do you as a black American feel safe? Where do you feel threatened? Why are we still afraid? That was question number one, and everything else just flowed after that. And books are here. I hope you will get a copy. I have a website, askingourselvesthetoughquestions.com. You are free to go there and answer the questions. The questions in this book will form the basis for book number two. I'm going to take the questions and the answers that come from the website, post them in the second book. Everybody's going to be free.
What was that website again?
askingourselvesthetoughquestions.com. Okay. Everyone, I am not writing the second book. I don't know what's taking me so long not to write it. But anyway, I've been doing so many other things that I put myself last. But this year I said, no, I'm working on this book this year. Asking Ourselves the Tough Questions, the second book, will be written probably by Black America. Everyone's free to contribute, because they would ask the questions. And then we'll put the answers out there for the next book for everyone to answer again. And that's how we're going to go through all the five books. My vision for the fifth book is our questions answered as best that we can, address our concerns as best as we can. So what I'm doing is really formalizing this process. As a matter of fact, my old blog, the first person who asked the question was not a black person. It was the question on abortion, which upset her totally. And at that point, I decided that because I responded to her. And at that point, that was in 2010 when I first put that old website. At that point, I made a decision. I do not answer the tough questions I ask them. It is not about me. It is about Black America. It's about the concerns and the issues. And I don't pretend, put out there, I don't, you know, attest to knowing those answers. I want the answers. I want to know what they think. I want to know what you think. And as you do your questions and answers, they go to me all the way, then you can address this question, the first one. How did that make you feel with me reading that? And you're not a black man, but how, as a white man, and I'm referring to Nick Scarcey. I don't know who Nick Scarcey is.
Chicken noodle or
he's on FX or something. He looked at my book and called me every other kind of racist, which is fine. I let Nick roll with that. I'll tell you why I let him roll. They got the top five show on FX. It wasn't starting up again until January. I will go back to Nick later on so that we can fight again on Twitter. But anyway, you can decide. You say it. You tell me. Is the first question racist or is it not? How do you feel about it? How does it make you feel as possibly the white man being on the other side of that question? So that's one of the questions we can ask here. But what I wanted to do, let me just say one more word about that question. I'm so prepared. But anyway, I have the gift of gab. I do have a radio network. I've been talking nonstop for like 3 or 4 years. I took a little rest. My organization is Chicago's Black Business Network. If you look at it now, it's in blog form. I did have a name with 1,000 people and all these people and all these blogs and all these pictures, and I got kind of tired of that. So what we've moved into as Chicago's Black Business Network, how I want to move forward with my business, is that we do social media management and training. I have a Twitter webinar for beginners for March the 8th. That's the direction that I'm going in now. Probably most of you are business owners. I know a lot of small business owners, and they're outnumbered and outgunned out here on this social media thing. So I'm starting at the beginning, and I'm hoping that I've read about 10 books on Twitter. And I want to take people with me through this and make it as easy as possible. Some people will maybe never get it, but make it possible for small businesses to compete just a little bit because they are outgunned and outnumbered by those who have the money in every arena, and now they're being swallowed up by social media. They don't have the money to compete, nor do they have the people and the jobs to compete with them. They can't hire social media managers to do their social media all day. A lot of them, one person companies, two, three, four people, they don't have a staff to keep up with what's going on. So we're moving towards training the best that we can, right to the point, get right to it and help them out. One of the things, the first question we can talk about in that order was question and answer, or if you have a comment now, you're free to on that, that's up to you.
Okay, so is that, that's it? Okay, well that was a,
no,
that,
that's
that's
whole,
all?
No.
Okay. I thought you meant that you were finished with your lecture. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to jump the gun.
Oh, one more thing.
Okay, sure.
I want to throw a couple more questions out there.
Oh, sure.
And so then they can pick the question they want to.
Oh, okay.
How many more minutes do I have?
Oh, go on as long as you want. I mean, it's, yeah. You can go on until, not quite as long as you can go on.
Chicken noodle?
Yeah,
for an hour. Up to an hour if you want.
Up to an hour.
Oh, okay.
You go on for an hour.
Boy, he was drinking
more coffee.
Okay, I'm sorry. I thought you were finished. I'm sorry.
No, if they had a question, if they had a remark about that.
No, you can go on for an hour.
That was you did. Okay. Good. You could have done it. Okay.
Okay.
Don't pay any attention to me. All right. You're good. I left my. Don't leave my notes. You see a red notebook. Can you give it to me, Shane? No, we have note first. But anyway, one other question I would like to share with you. I'm going to share a little story because I put a few stories in here, but not many. But I am going to share one story with you and one concern with you. But I just want to throw another few questions out there for you. Raise your hands. Well, let me ask the question first. Corporations are now free to arbitrate racial discrimination complaints. Not only racial discrimination, could be sex, gender, disability. They're free to arbitrate if you sign an employment agreement. Okay. Corporations are now free to arbitrate racial discrimination complaints, although most arbitrators in the United States are white. Do you feel that a member of another ethnic group can make a fair decision in a case regarding racial discrimination? And let me add to this question. How do you feel about discrimination cases, whether it's regarding disability, sex, gender, race, whatever it is, not being taken to court? A couple of things come into play, and you may know more than I do if the law is sitting in this room. That number one, no longer is there a public record of what these companies are doing. Number two, for the sake of a job, are you giving up rights that was that were given to us constitutionally? Okay. Judge Kennedy made that decision. There was a case with Circuit City a few years ago, and he made that decision that that would be the case, that corporations could now arbitrate these cases. There would be an arbitrator to judge, and there would be no appeal. So you tell me how you feel signing an employment agreement, taking away your rights, or do you feel that's fine with you? That's one of the questions I want to put out there for you, okay, across the board. Another one, I'm going to give you, you pick what what makes you hot. Throw it out there. I think now what I want to do is, let me check this other one. I want to ask one that's really applicable to everybody. Applicable to you, applicable to me. It's question number 57. And it's regards, well, you'll figure out what it's regards. Everyone in here is intelligent. What have you given? What have you given? Not your ancestors, not your mother, your father, not what happened in Ireland or Spain or Africa or Australia. What have you given, you not your ancestors? What will you give in this country to make a difference? What are you asking of America? What is due to you from America? Is anything due to you? That's question number 57. What are you asking of America? And what have you personally given? I have to ask that of myself, and that's the question out to you. That's the other one. And, because it pretty much seems like everybody feel like something is due to them. And I'm trying to find out what's due to you. We don't want to do abortion. No, we don't want to do abortion. Let's do, abortion's been done. Everybody got their side. They want to spit about it, fight about it. We already know the figures, don't we? 50 million children murdered. We know the figures already. Now, my final question, and I'm going to tell you why this came to me that I wanted to do this 2 weeks ago, actually. As I told someone, I pretty much get tired of being the one telling on people. They call me, am I a snitch? If we don't have a snitch, how will we know what's going on? Am I a whistleblower? I don't know. Maybe I am. But I was spotting someone who was acting inappropriately with a child, and I reported them to the church down the street. Okay? This is not only a concern of mine personally. I think, and I'm sure why it's a personal concern, I'm going to tell you a little story. My question is, who are the protectors of our children? We have predators everywhere. We have them in the house that we live in. We have them on our blocks. We have them in our schools, in our churches, in the places where there's recreation. We have predators everywhere in different forms, from sexual to just harassment and abuse and bullying. Who are the protectors of our children? And across the world, we got people, and majority women, and I don't know if women do it or not, who fly to other countries to abuse children. And is this something, Mr. Anderson, that we don't talk about enough?
The abuse of children?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, it's one of the top 10 blacked out subjects in America.
Absolutely.
By the press. The press is almost non-existent on this problem.
Absolutely. So my question number 64 is not even that, but I'll tell you how I came to that. Question number 64 is, who are your heroes? And who do you admire the most? And although I'm a Superman fan from a little bitty girl, I didn't know how he died. My mother says, Superman died. Well, how did he die? I was 5. He jumped out the window. Well, how could he jump out the window? He could fly. Until that time, I didn't know the TV wasn't real. I'm like, I don't understand. She said, it's not real. And it just confused me. That's when I knew TV wasn't real. So from a little girl, and it hurt me very badly. From a little girl, I'm a Superman fan. But that's not what I'm talking about. Who are your heroes? Who do you admire? There are people in each of our lives who have given us greatly. And sometimes we need to sit back and examine who they are and who made the difference that made us who we are. I think it's a song, I am who I am because of what you did for me. And we do need to examine that sometimes in our busy, busy life. I want to tell you a story, and I'm kind of going to read it and paraphrase it about my hero, and then that's going to be the final thing, okay? I was very young, 12 years old. Kenneth Johnson was younger. He was 5 years old. We lived on the first floor, a small two flats, and Kenneth and his family lived upstairs. The Johnsons were in their late 20s, and they had 4 children. Whenever the young couple would go out, I was the children's playmate slash babysitter. And we'd have a good time. We played games. For me, it was like playing. I'm still young. I'm still a child. And although I was young, they knew they were safe. And that I love being in charge, and I love small children, even from them. The elderly couple who had previously lived in that apartment had been the owners of the building, and they had 4 foster children. Kenneth's mother was their granddaughter. And when the mother died, all of the foster children, except for Robert, were returned to their parents, to the state. Maybe there was no place for him to go, which I believe that was the case. He moved in with the elderly gentleman and his new wife in a house two doors down. Now, Robin and I had been at war since I was small enough to crawl up under a bed. Well, you know, back then, that's more than 1955, the beds were a little bit higher, but they weren't like that high. So I was very small. So we had been in war since I was able to crawl under a bed. That's my earliest memory of him chasing me and grabbing me in a sexual manner. I would come to play with the other kids and he began grabbing me and touching me, and I would run and slide under his mother's bed. He was trying to get me from under there, but he was too big to crawl under there and reach me. I knew even then that he was afraid of getting caught, so he coached me out with smoothing words and that he was not going to bother me. This game or this attack of cat and mouse went on and on. I was just as intense and determined that he would not get a grip on me. I had always sent the signal that I was ready to fight. The first few times I could crawl under the bed, but after a while I was too big and I had to stand and fight or take flight. As Robert got older and bigger and stronger, he became more aggressive. It became harder and harder to fight him off, but he came knowing that there would be a battle. I don't believe that he was yet old enough to be that sure of himself. Fast forwarding to my being 12 and Robert being 17 years of age, somehow he got wind that I was upstairs with the children babysitting. We were sitting on the sofa watching TV when the door opened. All of us turned and looked. As he spoke, he moved from the door over to me and he said, I'm gonna get me some today. I was thinking, how did he know I was up here? Fear rose up in me and I was prepared. Yes. I prepared myself for a fight. I felt fear. When he moved in for the attack, I was still sitting on the sofa because it seemed like in one motion he was from the door to the sofa and there was no time to do anything else. As we struggled, he was on my right side sitting on the sofa and he was trying to push me down into a laying position. He was trying to get a grip on my hands and arms and could not because I was swinging them all at the same time. If he could have stopped me from hitting him, he could have mounted me. I kept fighting to keep control or to keep him from gaining control. For some reason, I didn't want to start screaming because I didn't want to scare the children. Too late, I looked to my left, and the three smaller children were huddled against the wall watching us. They had this bewildered, wide-eyed, and confused look on their faces. One of them looked like one of those deer caught in the headlights expressions. Kenneth, I was standing here, Robert was there. Kenneth was standing in front of Robert, a little bit off to his right, about a foot or two away from him. I couldn't say what he was thinking, but in retrospect, he was gauging the situation. He was 5 years old. Maybe at first he didn't perceive that I was in danger. There was no fear in his face. I don't recall seeing any sense of panic in his eyes. This little boy was just standing there, watching us doing battle with no expression on his face. Then things changed. It seemed fast and in slow motion at the same time. Now I was the observer. I will never be sure, but maybe this little boy sensed, after giving the situation some thought, that I might just lose this battle. Quite unexpectedly, quite wondrously, this 5-year-old boy leaped on this 17-year-old and began to beat him so viciously that he could not maintain his grip on me for having to defend himself against this child's blows. Kenneth was beating him and screaming and screaming and screaming, take your hands off her, you stop, you don't touch her, you leave her alone. It was happening so fast, he was moving so fast that I could not keep up with what was happening. Those little arms were moving and swinging and clawing. It looked like something flashing before my eyes. Watching it would make you say, what the hell? Robert was trying not to hurt or injure him, just trying to stop Kenneth from hitting him. Robert was laughing at him at first. He thought that it was funny. He tried to grab his arms, tried to calm him down, tried to hang on to me at the same time. It didn't work quite like he expected. He had to let me go. I was looking directly into Robert's face when that child wiped that smile off of his mug. He was taking a good look at that child attacking him. I watched the change taking place. I heard the change in his tone, his voice, his whole being as he tried to assure Kenneth that he would not touch me ever again. He was trying to hold Kenneth down and tell him that he was going to stop him, that he was not going to touch me. Calm down, man, calm down. He kept saying, okay, man, okay, okay, okay. He repeated these words over and over again. I was frozen. I didn't know how to move. I only knew how to watch as a participant in a movie with a surprise ending that was never even written into the script. Robert was finally able to calm Kenneth down, and we both sit there staring at this little boy who was sobbing, taking these huge, loud breaths. His whole body was going up and down. He had asthma. He was trying to catch his breath. His whole little body was going, he's trying to catch his breath. The attack itself was a shock, but hollering and crying took it over the edge. It seemed that that child had gotten so wound up that he couldn't come down immediately. He finally calmed down, and he told him one more time, leave her alone. Don't you ever touch her again. I was taken aback as I sat there that day, but Robert was taken further. Robert told him that he would not touch me again, and he never did. Without regard to the size or the might of the enemy, this little boy moved into position, executed an attack, and was victorious. He left the enemy and potential rapist empty and impotent. Robert stood up from the sofa as we all watched him straighten his clothes. He told me he was sorry and that he would never touch me again. He told me that I had nothing to worry about. I could only think that if shame had a bad smell, it would smell just like Robert Johnson. Here and now, I wonder if Robert Johnson remembers the day that a 5-year-old boy became more of a man than he ever would be. Thank you so much.
Very good.
We moved a few blocks away, but I didn't go back down to that house and where they lived. And then after a little while, their father died, had an asthma attack on the front stairs, he died. The mother took custody, but it had to be taken away from her, and then they moved, and I never saw him again. A couple of years after that. So no, I don't know where Robert is or what he's doing. Or Kenneth.
All right.
Yes.
Okay, all right, Tim, did you have a question?
Can you elaborate a little bit about what the book writing process was like and how long it took you, and who was your publisher on the book?
There was really no process. I got up that morning, I wrote. All the rest of it was really editing. I did ask some other questions at the end. I don't know how it came about. It just came like that. But I self-published the Create page, and so it went, it's on Amazon, and it came out 2010. I haven't done much with it. I'm not finished with that. You know, I moved on to other things. This was not my original cover on Create Page. You know, you can publish free on Create Page, and they upload it to Amazon. That's why there's so many books now. And Kindle. And you can upload free to Kindle.
Oh, wow. How about that?
Yes.
Upload free to Kindle. Okay.
Yes.
All right. That's pretty cool. Let's,
Create Page, right. And is what you used?
Excuse me?
The website was called Create Page.
Create Page, yeah. Okay. Create Space, I'm so sorry.
Create space.
Yes. And there's no charge, you can upload it.
Mm-hmm.
And they pay you royalties. Yeah.
Okay. Right. How does it get printed?
On demand.
All right. I would just like to say that if you have a question, raise your hand. I'll call on people and raise your hand. So does anybody else have a question? No? Oh, Carl.
Okay.
Yeah.
In your enumerating your questions, in the first question, you had mentioned the Bridgeport neighborhood. Do you live near there? And then how did it influence, you know, your life?
That question? You know, I wish I could tell you how that came to be the first question. I have no idea how that came to be the first question. Why would I sit down there and say, I'm going to write a book by asking Black American a tough question? And why that would come to be the first question, I would not know. But I did. I lived at 35th in Princeton, where Comiskey Ballpark now sits. As a matter of fact, my grandfather sold his house to Comiskey Ballpark. So, yes, my mother My grandfather had a house there, so my mother and her siblings grew up there. So I've heard those stories, not only from her, from many, 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 many people. You can still hear them now, really, if you listen.
No, I can't
hear them. So yes, I did grow up in that community. So we do know that community, and it's such a strange thing, and it might be a bad thing to say. When I put the book out and I had the story, little paragraph about Bridgeport, my mother said, because my mother didn't raise me, you know, she moved to California out of a domestic situation when I was like 9. And she said, Mama, which is her mother who raised me, she said, Mama used to take you over to Bridgeport. Well, yes, we did used to go over to Bridgeport. And there's a story about that in there. She said, yeah, we used to go over to Bridgeport. She used to take us over there. And then she gave us all switchblades when we went over there. And she says, anybody mess with you, you cut them up. And that was her story. Maybe if she had told me sooner. But I said, I never heard that, did she? She said, yeah, she used to do that. And she also told me that same day. She said, yeah, we used to go over there. We used to walk down Mayor Daly's block to Daly's block. And we knew we weren't supposed to do that, you know. We knew we weren't supposed to do that. But we would go over there anyway and talk about the names that people would call them. And she accused them of being into him and his brother. I said, well, how do you know it was them? I said, it's been a long time making mistakes. She said, I'm not mistaken. They used to do it, too. We used to go over there on purpose. Then they walked down to the police station on 35th and Wallace and tell the police they're trying to kill us. And the police told them, you have no business being over here. So, yes, we do know that neighborhood. But then vice versa. You know, the little white kids used to come over. They wouldn't let them in the little league, and they used to beat them up when they come over there. So it's back and forth. This is just a mess. That's what it is. Yes.
All right. Any other questions? Okay, Gene.
Yeah. Could you? I heard something. Could you tell a little more about your business, the name of it, what you actually do, and is that your main source of income?
Unfortunately, it is. I'm not as great a business person as I want to be. I'm going into it. My network, which is started out being a social media network, I came out of the real estate industry. And 2007, December, I wrote my last loan, and my biggest one too. But then after that, I quit. And I started the social network in 2008 as a means of when, because I knew the industry would come back eventually. When the industry comes back, I'll have a referral source. I'll have a base of referrals. I have a business base already. And that was my only intention. But then people said, you want to do events, you know. So, well, sure, I'll do something. Because I named it Chicago's Black Business Network. So, absolutely, they thought it was a network, and that's what you're supposed to do. I didn't know. I'm just pushing a button and starting a network. You just open up a website. But what I do now is social media management. My mission has changed. That's what I want to grow into and learn. Social media management and service small businesses and organizations. And that means I will manage their Twitter account, manage their Facebook accounts, write blogs, write press releases, which I have press releases. Whatever it is they need as far as web development, that's where my business is growing into. And yes, unfortunately, it is. As I learn, I'm learning as I'm living, it is my main source of income right now.
Thank you.
All right.
Charlie, you have a question.
Yeah, Sonja, the Republican Party seems to have some issues with our current president of the United States. Do you have any candid opinion then on that whole situation?
You know, I don't answer the tough questions I ask. Did you get that? There is the only question I asked about the current sitting president is, did you vote for him in 2008? And get some interesting responses on that. I have a friend, Jimmy Tillman. I know all you know Dorothy Tillman, former Alderman Dorothy Tillman. Jimmy Tillman is running for Congressman Bobby Rush's seat, Republican, 1st Congressional District. I did an interview with him last week. You have to listen to the interview. Chicago's Black Business Radio Network. I'm starting my radio network back up. And as a Black Republican, you should listen to the interview. I'll put it like that. Chicago's Black Business Radio Network. And that might give you some insight into what he thinks of the current sitting president.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
if we're talking politics, who are you backing for governor?
That's okay.
You too. Now, see, you're asking me a question again. And as a matter of fact, you know his campaign manager is on there, MIM, you can find on Facebook, Felicity, T.O. Hardman. He had a ceasefire, he got kicked out of ceasefire, running for governor. Her and I chit-chat back and forth. I'm not really into politics. My temperament really doesn't permit it. I'd be fist fighting in the street. It would just be real ugly. And my mouth would just not be clean enough to be sitting in city council or anywhere. I really don't do politics. I don't really do support. I just know Jimmy. I've known Jimmy for like 20-some years. I knew Dr. Jimmy, who was the music producer for the Black Ensemble Theater. He was part on it and the music director for Black Ensemble Theater years and years and years ago. I sold him a building like 20 years ago. So I know him from a long time. I really don't know Dorothy Tillman. I hear she's a tagger on wheels. But I really don't know her, and I've never met her, but I've met her children, and I've met her ex-husband. But I don't really do politics. I think it's best for some people to stay out of it. What you think? I think it's best for some people just to stay out of some things, and I'm one of the people. You know me, Tina.
All right. Any other questions? I'll get to you in a moment, Tim. But, ma'am, did you have a question?
So, you mentioned that you don't answer the tough questions because they're not easy ones, so not easy to answer. So what is your intent or what is the goal of your book then for others?
The title, Black America Asking Ourselves the Tough Questions, to just create a formalized process for the dialogues, address their concerns and their issues, how they feel on it. And not only that, what are your solutions? And if that's your solution, what you gonna do about it? That's really my intention. I'd like to hear some of the arbitration question. Yes, sir.
Wait, just a moment. Let me call on the people. I want to make sure it's done. First of all, I had a question. I'll get to you in a moment.
Oh, don't worry about it.
Any other questions for now? No. Okay. Because I guess my real question is there anybody who has a question who has not already asked a question? Yes, Andy.
The story you told about the young boy wanting to have, force you to have sex. do you think that behavior is more prevalent in the black community than the white community, or do you think, or is it related to growing up in a certain economic environment?
You want to ask me the tough questions, don't you? It's very difficult.
Okay.
What I will say is this, how I see it, and it cannot possibly be, and I think most people know it.
What?
Nothing to do with color. Low morals.
Okay. Now, you're Dave, right?
Yeah.
Okay, Dave, did you have a question?
No.
Okay, you had your hand up. You said,
is there anybody who hasn't asked a question?
Oh, right. Okay. Okay,
Don't ask that question.
Okay, all right. My question actually was, is there anybody who has a question who has not already asked a question? But that's not the same thing. I have a question. I wanted to ask you, have you read the book The New Jim Crow by Michelle Alexander? And if so, what did you think of it?
I started listening to the audio. I found it very difficult. I found it very, very difficult. Because you have to, and I don't know if you have to, but whoever ethnic group or nationality you may be, when you start sitting down and listening to the abuses and listening to what happened, it doesn't make for good feelings, and it doesn't make for good relationships, and it was a hard book to listen to. I didn't listen to it all the way. It's very good.
So you found it kind of painful.
Yes,
to listen
I found
to.
It very painful.
Oh.
But very good, and I will read it probably.
Okay.
Listening to it was very difficult.
Okay.
Have you read it?
Yes, I read it cover to cover.
What you think?
Well, I'm not black,
So it wouldn't affect me.
You're not?
And so it wouldn't affect me the same way.
Well, how did it affect
you? Well, I was kind of shocked, to tell you the truth. Yeah, I was. I was a little bit shocked because the way she's saying is that things today were worse than I had thought. Mm-hmm. And the evidence is pretty, you know, it's pretty irrefutable. So I was a little bit shocked by it.
You know what, I'm gonna tell you, people work hard, they're working 9 to 9, they're trying to raise the kids, they're trying to do all this stuff. Don't have time to look at all of it. I mean, you don't find time to be concerned about a lot probably that's not almost sitting right in front of your face. I mean, it takes a lot of energy to give that extra time to being concerned anyway. Even me or anybody else, and that's part of what's going on, and that's part of what, you know, the powers that be trust. They can depend on that you're too busy and you're too concerned trying to struggle and live out here, that we don't have to worry about you being concerned. We can do you next. We don't have to worry about you, and they do you, no matter what you think, they do you every day. They do you in the taxes, they do you when they sell off privatized services for little or no. They do it all the time, okay? You can tell by this College of Complex discussion, FRAC, this tax legislation, they do you all the time, but you're sitting around thinking they're not doing you. You're doing you, they're in the back room somewhere doing you right now. You just don't think they're doing you. You know they, you know, if you really think about it, they are doing you. But we're so busy that we can't keep up because they got full-time jobs to get paid, good salaries to do us. And we just don't have enough people to keep up with it all.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Dave, you had a question?
Yeah, what do you mean they do you all the time?
They do. How can I put that?
They do you. What do you mean by that?
Use you.
Because you're wrong.
Who does that?
For lack of a better word, and the day maybe it's the top 1%, the richest power brokers in America, the ones who are in control, whoever's in control, you can call it the government, you can call it the top 1%.
Are you saying they make a profit on us?
Absolutely.
Is that what you're saying?
Sure.
No.
I'm saying that you're a slave.
You don't know that?
I'm saying you may be a slave yourself and you don't even know it. You don't look at yourself as a slave.
Yep.
But you are.
All right, Pat.
Yeah, so what you're really saying, this is not exclusively a black issue. It is an issue for virtually everyone who is not part of the quote-unquote 1%. Because I know plenty of people who look like me who are being done, and they know it. And they are frustrated, and they're mad. I detect a lot of resurgent anger coming up, and it has nothing to do with race.
And I'll just say this final thing. What, to me, takes place, they can squash that by making it even harder for you to maintain your state of living, because you'll start struggling more and paying more attention to try to hang on to your mortgage, your child's education, whatever it is. All you have to do is raise some more taxes. All they have to do is pull some resource out of you, and it makes it harder for you, it makes it more of a struggle for you, and you got to focus in on that, and you can't focus in on what they're doing when you're hanging on by a thread, when they might be getting ready to tow your car and trash it within a few hours of towing it, because you owe the state money and the city money. There are so many ways that they do you, that they pretty much do everybody in a different way. But you may not realize it because maybe you feel privileged.
Okay.
And if you feel special, have them happy for you.
Yeah. All right. Sir, you had another question.
Yeah. Sonja, I want to go back to your initial description. You're 58, 59 now, and you look back at that 17-year-old. What are your thoughts now about that 17-year-old? How should he be, what should be done about him if it was happening today?
What should be done about him if he was having a day? Actually, I only saw him like once or twice after that. Didn't say much, hello, goodbye. I saw him again when I was 22 on a bus. He saw me first. And he begged my apology, begged my apology, begged my apology. There's jail for him. I mean, he should actually be put in jail. As a 17-year-old, let me just share one thing. I did tell my mother when I was very small, and I want you to listen to this. I'm looking at the women. I want you to listen to this. I did try and tell my mother when I was very small that he was bothering me, but I didn't have the right language to tell them exactly how he was bothering me. And he was standing there laughing. I mean, I was still small. I wasn't 12 yet. And he was laughing. I'm not bothering her. And my mother was saying, you don't hit her. You leave her alone. And I was trying to tell my mom, that's not what he's doing. He's not here. But I don't think I had the right language. It means you need to be aware of what's going on with everybody in your house.
All right. Tim, I know I skipped you over. Did you still have a question?
Yes. You've been talking a lot about people doing you and the increasing amount of usury that is in society. What, in your words, and it's a tough question, but I'd like you to answer it if you could.
Maybe.
What is it that might turn this around, or perhaps maybe bring a sense of moral character back into society so that this do you epidemic doesn't keep going on?
I don't think it's has to do with morals. I think you need to stop feeling privileged.
Can you elaborate just a little bit about what you mean by privilege and how can we stop that?
In my view, looking at this black skin out into the world, and it is nothing new.
Okay.
You know, it makes it appear, the powers that be, I want to use the language, makes it appear that you're not being done.
Okay.
But you are being done. You need to stop being stupid. That would mean just stop being stupid. I mean, people could, you know, what'd your mother say? You find a fool, bump their head, stop getting your head bumped. Take a look at what's going on in your life.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Can't stop them.
All right, Charlie, do you have another question?
Yeah, Sonja, I don't know if you know the details, but you said the corporations try to get newly hired employees to waive the right to file EEO charges.
Absolutely.
And go to arbitration. Do you know the conditions of the arbitration? Or, I mean, there's situations like loser pays, lawyer fees, anything.
This is how it works, and believe me, I know. Once you sign an employment agreement to arbitrate, there's only two ways you can get a court hearing. One, if the EEOC, you file an EEOC, and they take the case, and we know what a small percentage that will be. No, you can get a right to sue. If you sign an agreement to arbitrate, that's a waste of your time to file to go to court, because you've agreed to arbitrate to get that job. Okay, that's one way, and we know that's almost impossible. The second way, in that employment agreement, if perchance, and they do make that mistake, I hope there's no corporate people in here go back and put that in their employment agreement. In that employment agreement, if they did not agree to pay your arbitration fees, take them to court.
All right.
In the state of Illinois. That's how you get around it. If they did not put that in that employment agreement, that they agree to pay for no arbitration cost, it take them to court. That's how you win that case.
All right. Are there any other, does anybody else have a question? Yes, Dave.
Yes, when you said they do you.
We're back to this.
Who are the people you're talking about that do you? Are you saying that it's the government?
Yes.
That it's big corporations?
Yes.
The 1%.
Oh, so you're saying it's both big government or government and corporations,
yes,
that do you all the time?
Yes.
But by do you, you mean make a profit on you, or do you,
yes,
mean get you in the trick bag somehow?
Use you up until you die.
I'm sorry?
Use you up until you die. That's what I mean by that.
You ready for me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Any other questions? Did you have a question?
Well, I thought we were going to answer some of her tough questions.
Well, we could do that in the rebuttal period.
Yes.
In the rebuttal period,
you get 5 minutes.
If there are no other questions, maybe we can move on.
Let's get everybody.
We're going to move on to the rebuttal period now.
Guys haven't had a tough question in 10
years. All right,
I'm cool.
All right, we're going to move on. Oh, excuse me. One pool at a time, ma'am. Okay.
How was the meat supposed to be?
All right. Now, we're going to move on to the rebuttal period. So what I would like is... what are you guys talking about over there?
I got a plan.
Just share your thoughts with us now from there.
No, I love that line, one pool at a time.
Yeah, we're
right.
Teachers, we're going to use that.
Right, okay.
Oh, goodness. Yeah.
Okay.
You're listening. All right, now,
first of all, I'd like a show of hands. Everybody who wants to give a rebuttal speech, raise your hand. Okay, I'm going to count. Keep those hands up, people. I'm going to count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Do your rebuttal.
7. And that's
what's that? Your rebuttal.
8 and 9. Because I'm going to give a speech too. So that's, all right, 5 minutes each.
Now,
these are the on deck chairs. Just sit down in these chairs here and form a line. This will be the chair for the person first in line.
Oh, come on.
Okay, who wants to be the first victim?
What the hell?
Go ahead, Charlie.
Charlie, use some bet on that haircut or what?
To this.
You want me to get that chair?
I guess I would use the words privilege and supervision. Toward the end of the rebuttals, I heard the word privilege. Well, to me, without looking at a dictionary, there's two parts of privilege. Maybe you've got a privilege to practice medicine if you've got an MD or an OD. Or maybe you can privilege to drive your car. I can't. Reason? I got lousy eyes. There's another privilege, and that's the privilege we're probably talking about here. That's something that's unearned. And of course, that goes back through the whole history of what is wrong with things. And part of that is the other word I use, and that's supervision. I spent my work life as a rehabilitation counselor. I worked for the state of Illinois. And I had what I thought was a great career. Unlike a lot of people in this room, I've got a pension. I've got health care, dental care. I guess that's a privilege that I partly earned, at least partly earned. But all during that time, I was supervised. I was supervised by two entities. My boss, the last one was Doris Brown. I didn't want to hear her calling me on the phone and saying, Gene, would you come down to my office, which was 5 or 6 miles away? I'd like to have a talk with you. That call never came to me. I guess the reason was I had another supervisor. That was my own superego. I had to at least be able to look in the mirror and follow a set of values, beliefs, and I hope I followed those. I try to follow them today. Although if I were a Catholic, I know if I died right now, I'd go to hell for eternity. Not to worry, I'm a Unitarian Universalist. We make our own rules, okay? And then we try to follow them. But those are the problems that we've got in our society. We've got a lot of people that don't seem to have to operate under the rules. And I see the audience here, about 80% of us, I can't see very well. But while it's unusual, you got some women here, that's a little unusual. About 80% of the audience here is usually male. And when we come to not being supervised and using a privilege that's not earned, I'm afraid we males are the main transgressors. Thank you.
Okay. Oh, boy,
all right.
so glad to hear
okay,
me.
Okay, who else wants to speak?
Be nice and more of us did.
All right.
Next
How about
up?
You, Pat? All right. Tonight's program was billed as tough questions and probably not very available answers from the black community. The fact of the matter is all of the issues that were discussed tonight apply to the white community, the Hispanic community, the Eskimo community, you name it. When our speaker asked if we were black lads going through Bridgeport, would we be afraid? Well, the question might also be asked, would a young white lad going through parts of the West Side at 2 o'clock in the morning in a heavily gang-infested area, and that white lad looks more like me than our speaker, I can guarantee you if I were walking through that neighborhood at 3 o'clock in the morning, I would be very much afraid too. It has nothing to do with race. It has a great deal to do with my fear that I might soon be meeting my maker if I don't get out of that neighborhood quickly enough. There are simply problems that we all face, regardless of color, because the problems are not that much different. We are all, whether we are white, black, polka dot, what have you, faced with a situation where the system, the 1%, whether we want to admit it or not, calls the shots. Now, we can occasionally rise up and revolt, and we can occasionally get some reforms, but, you know, the situation keeps going on and on and on. We are all being done in one way, shape, or form. What they like to have us all think is that we are not being done. That it is those people over there who might be done, or those people over there who might be done, but not us. You know, we're not being done. We're you know, that's why when they tried to unionize clerical workers back in the 1950s and 60s, some of you guys will remember this, they would call in some of the leaders of this organizing effort and say, you know, we have always considered you to be a part of our management family. You wear a white shirt and a tie just like we do.
Oh.
You are destined to join us in our positions as soon as the opportunity, as soon as there is a vacancy. So how can you turn on your own family? And this is the kind of appeal that they have made time and time again. I was involved in an effort, a successful effort, I might add, to bring the union back to the Lerner newspapers, which, you know, later were merged into Pioneer. And one of the things that they did was they called various people in, and they said to one person, because I talked to them afterwards, we consider you part of the family. Well, this is a family argument, but it doesn't need to be a bitter family argument. Or they would say, you know, the only guy that is going to benefit from this unionizing effort are the people with seniority, and, you know, that guy Butler down the hall, he's the one who really wants this because he will virtually have tenure for life and all of this kind of thing. And you, who were hired just a month or two ago, you will have nothing to gain. And so they try to divide, and that's how they conquer. One of the things that unions have always stressed has been solidarity. The fact is that workers of all backgrounds, regardless of seniority, regardless of their position, have got to stick together. And I see our chairman, our honorable chairman, looking at his watch. So I think I better watch myself and head back.
No, he's still
okay.
Got me.
All
Okay, I've got the a clock over here.
Oh, you do?
Yes.
Oh, you're timing it. Okay.
Oh, yeah. This is not some seat of the pants
operation. I was watching my wristwatch.
All right, thanks. Let's thank our speaker again for a very nice presentation coming out on a cold evening here. I'll be eclectic as usual. Actually, this evening I'm going to talk about a topic I actually know something about. And she talked about, I'm a union official. I've been doing this for a number of years. And the issue, if you don't understand this, this is technical, that's just too darn bad. But it's very important. Now, there's an EEO complaint process. If you feel you've been discriminated against by the employer, you can elect to pursue resolution through an EEO process. There is another process. As a matter of fact, I my work involved in about 12 processes. And there's another one in which called the grievance arbitration process. Now, you want to see, in selecting a process, you obviously want the one that's most likely to be successful to you in getting the results that you seek, or the resolution, as we call it in the trade. You got to be cool and cautious in any occasion in which you waive a right. And management has rights, employees have rights, and the unions have rights. And actually, in negotiating contracts, I have waived rights of employees on occasion in order to get something better in return. But that's very rare. Once you waive a right, it's clear and unmistakable, you can't retreat on it. So it's got to be cautious here. Now, the thing about, like, the EEO, I'm going to return back to the EEO complaint process. There's an inherent burden in any of this discrimination thing is that the burden of proof is on the employee. And that's tough. Because you have to get it. It's not just like I use the expression, you feel you've been discriminated against. Is that just a feeling you have in your heart? And you have to prove it. And when the burden of proof is on you, it's a big thing that drops on you. And try to get witnesses or co-workers, have they put it in writing?
Can I have an
answer? What were the situations? Do you have witnesses? Do you have qualified witnesses? Things of that nature. EEO process, unfortunately, and there's various reasons for this. It doesn't mean the process is all that bad, but the success rate is only about 10% or less. Now, there's a lot of lawyers out there who take your money, and I've helped them. People are fully willing, I'll gladly help you go into general lawyer. That's fine, I've worked with them. But I'll let you know that some of them out there collect a lot of money out of you, and there's an economic settlement in EEO cases that they collect at the end. You know, it's really, I'm sorry I use the term sharks, but I'll work with them. Because I want to see what's good for the person and the employee. And I'll work with anybody. I'll make arrows out of any kind of wood. Grievance arbitration is a different thing. It's when you hire an arbiter. And there have to be qualified individuals with a background in labor management relations and things like that. And there's associations in which they're certified. There's even union officials who serve as arbiters, things like that. And there's a process for selecting them. I do a lot of grievance arbitrations, and we have about a 50% chance of succeeding. So that's what you got to look at. Now, the thing about EEO, though, is basically, unless you get your own lawyer, it's a free process. It can be. That diminishes your chances of success, but it's generally not cost-attended to it. Grievance arbitration is either you've got to pay the arbiter, and no one is qualified in doing their own arbitration. You're just not something you're going to walk in. It's a hearing, it's like a mini kind of informal court. And no one is qualified to do it without some rigorous training, background, or experience at it. And just hiring an arbiter can be from anywhere $5,000 to $10,000 for one hearing. So it can be, it's an expensive thing. Discrimination is, that if we think it's easy to win or in the stuff in the courts, that's a lot of hooey. And it takes a lot of money of the little guy. And you talk about doing it to you, yeah, the corporations got a whole goddamn bunch of lawyers on the clock, and they'll drain you, and they'll drain you darn well. We're the little guys, but we still stand up to them. But I have to look at the conditions of the arbitration, of the situation here. Now, the fact that the corporations are writing the conditions of this, I wouldn't give it a spit on it. It's not even worthwhile. Because if I'm going to write some conditions of resolving disputes, and the guy's going to write his own, it's like designing your own court. You know, you're not going to get any objectivity. The only thing is, it might work out if you get a guy like me to handle your operation, because I'm at the top of my game right now. Anyhow, thank you very much. Sorry for boring you with some later lines. They fear me.
All right. Okay, who else wants to give a speech? Dave, come on up. Dave Zucker.
Oh, boy, Dave.
First of all, Sonja, I'd like to thank you for coming out tonight.
Thank you.
As Charlie said, on a nice cold February night. The situations that you propounded at the beginning of your talk are situations that, having grown up in this city as you did, being only a year older than you, I'm only all too familiar with. In 1955, I was a year old. That was also the year when Bridgeport's most famous citizen became the mayor of the city of Chicago. And yes, I well remember, was Mike Royko colorfully phrased it in his book Boss, that if a black person walked to Bridgeport and didn't look like they were waiting for a bus, and sometimes even if they did, or they didn't look like they were going somewhere to wash dishes, well, it was not a good idea to walk through Bridgeport under those conditions. In 1964, when I was 10 years old, I knew that you were talking about Jim Chaney and Mickey Schwerner and Andy Goodman. And I well remember when they disappeared, and I was visiting my grandparents in Kentucky, which is where my mother was from, when the remains of those three gentlemen were found in an earthen dam near Philadelphia, Mississippi. And so, yeah, if some car pulled up behind me at night in Mississippi with a red light on it, no, that's no guarantee of safety at all. In fact, I wonder if it's still a guarantee of safety down there. I don't know. I passed through Mississippi once on the train, and I visited Vicksburg with the Civil War Roundtable on its board I serve. But that's the extent of my acquaintanceship with the state of Mississippi. So how much has changed down there in 50 years, I'm not quite sure. Maybe Mr. Butler, who's the journalist in the room, has some more insight into that than I do.
I have been to Mississippi. We'll talk about it later.
Fair enough. And as for the last situation that you propounded, some car pulls up next to me and looks like that they're going to knock me off the road. I don't care what color I am. I don't care what color the people are in the next car. If they look like they're not going to knock me off the road, hell yes, I'm going to be scared. And as to the last situation that you talked about, now I worked for 30 years for the Circuit Court of Cook County, so I didn't have to deal with arbitration. And if I came from a background that's different from the one that I do, yes, I might be a little concerned about attending an arbitration hearing. Most of the people were white. But I will say this. I had, as my last supervisor before I left, a woman who was of Armenian origin, for whatever that's worth, who, while she gave me a nice party when I left, was not a particularly nice person. It was probably the most invasive supervisor I've ever had. And she caused enough problems that it took a union steward to help me save my job.
since, thank God, the Teamsters organized the chief judge's office at the circuit court when I was there, the union steward was black. Well, thanks to her, I retired after 30 years with a full pension. She enabled me to keep my job long enough so that I was able to stay and deal with the nasty Armenian supervisor. Finally, I had an uncle, who some of you may know, who was a lawyer by the name of Marshall Patner. And Uncle Marshall was in the trenches for from the late 50s through about the year until his death in the year 2000. He represented some of the people who come to the college with some of their problems. He represented Dick Gregory before the Supreme Court of the United States. Mr. Gregory was arrested in Bridgeport for picketing at Mayor Daley's house.
Okay, we need to wrap it up, Dave.
I'm almost done.
Okay.
And suffice it to say that he fought long and hard on many of the issues that have been discussed tonight. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. I don't like Armenians either.
Okay. Yeah. I don't have a problem with most Armenians, yeah. Just with her.
There's no Armenians
all right.
In here.
All right, who else wants to give a rebuttal speech? We Dave, got come on. Oh. Nothing, we got two Daves.
Oh, which is yours? All right, then pay that one out of that, too.
Okay.
All right.
Who's going next?
He's gone.
Okay, good.
We don't want any Armenians.
Okay. Oh, Armenians.
I apologize. I was to do someone a Diet Coke. Did you want to listen? Okay, I'm so sorry. Of course.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We don't have a microphone.
We haven't had a mic all night. All right, good evening. I was fortunate enough to meet a very nice black man on Central Avenue. This man acts very humble. He has a shoeshine parlor. Very pleasant fellow. He also owns half the block. I know of another black man down around 63rd and Cottage Grove that has a very prosperous business. My point is that you can be successful no matter what kind of a minority you are if you focus on your goal and not allow yourself to be forever caught up in skirmishes along the way. When our speaker, who I thought was a very good speaker, when she said about they'll do you, I want to point out that a corporation can advertise a new Chevy or a new Ford on television. You can turn the television off and say, I'll never buy a Ford. And there's nothing they can do about it. But if the government tells you to do something, you have to do it. I was listening to Bill Ayers last night on television, and he was talking about the Libertarian Party, and he said the Libertarians blame the government for a lot of things, but they think corporations are absolutely innocent. But that's not really true. The Libertarians they fault corporations just as much. The only thing is, once again, you can tell a corporation to go square to hell, and there isn't anything they can do about it. The government can force you to do whatever they want you to do. The government has way too much power. So if anyone is really doing someone, it is big government that is doing us all the time.
Not the corporations.
Wait
a minute.
I'll make a deal with you, Charlie. Okay? This has happened one time too many. I'm going to make a deal with you. You don't heckle me, and I won't heckle you. Now let's come to an agreement on that right now. Or else,
you can
I know the game, and I can play it real good. So let's come to an agreement right now
heckle me, and I won't heckle you.
No,
now,
you can
we have an understanding that way, or don't we?
No.
Okay.
Well, no. Okay, then. From now on, watch my smoke. I'm all finished.
Okay. All right, everyone. All right. All right. Anybody else? Anybody else care to give a rebuttal speech?
Yeah, we got a few more in here. Can we got five?
Okay. Did you have something to say?
Thank you, Charlie.
Oh. Okay. What about you,
Susie?
Yes, how about you? Will you?
The
bill. No.
I'll be back with your train.
I'm sure you have something to say.
Come on.
We want to hear from you.
Yay.
Let's give her a hand.
Let's do it.
What's that?
Hello.
Okay,
sweetheart. Can I
closer
to your mouth?
Everybody's
playing. Just a game.
Everybody's playing.
Seth got to speak up. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Sonja. Thank you very much for speaking. I really enjoyed your talk, and I'm for sure, even though I promised you 2 years ago to buy your book, I still haven't. I will buy it for sure. So one of the questions you asked is, what has my country done, or what do I want my country to do for me,
mm-hmm.
and what have I done for my country?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I hope that my country will keep their promise and pay my pension when I retire.
Right back.
What have I done for my country? Right, or I've taught the children for 34 years.
That's
it. So, and then here's the one thing about, we say that we can do whatever, be successful, but when you said the government, but I think corporations own the government, and they change the rules in the middle of the game. So,
yeah.
That's
all. All right. Yay. All right. Okay. Who else would like to speak? Okay. Any volunteers? All right.
How about a second round? We have lots of
well. Yes, indeed. We do have we do have plenty of time because it's only about 8 o'clock right now. So anybody want to go and give a second round? What about you, Dave? You want to? No, Andy. Okay, Andy. I knew you had something to say. Come on. All right.
I was part of the first round.
Yeah. Wait a second. Did you? You already gave.
I held my hand up. I didn't give a talk yet. I mean, rebuttal.
Okay. Hey, I know. I didn't think you gave a rebuttal speech.
No, I held my hand up. But
okay.
Andy, I got one of your books.
Right. Okay. Right.
That's all right.
Okay.
But
that's okay. We got plenty of time.
Tim go with the time. Well, I'll watch it.
No, Tim, I'll watch it. No, it's very hard to watch your own time speaking. I'll do it.
When you look at, okay, first off, one of my other hobbies is I'm a science coach for seventh graders for Science Olympiad.
Oh,
I'm in my 19th
Thanks.
Year of coaching seventh graders on building robotic and mechanical projects and stuff for a middle school out in Arlington Heights. We have some teachers here tonight. Are any of you familiar with the program of Science Olympiad?
Yes.
You know what that is? Well, at the school board every year when they give us a certificate of participation, I say, I want you all to know that, you know, being involved in Science Olympiad with kids this age is the most fun you can have without getting arrested. So, you know, working with kids, helping kids learn at that age is just enormously rewarding. And I probably wouldn't be here today. I would have had a heart attack from the stress of the political stuff in America if it wasn't for my participation in that program as a coach. It's just so much fun going to competitions and just practicing with kids and helping them learn stuff. We teach seventh graders. Universally, we say, in order to solve any problem, you have to first correctly identify the problem. In America, it's hard to identify problems because the media, the major media, promotes certain mythology in America. And if you don't know where the sources of documented evidence really is, you wouldn't know what really happened. They promoted the myth that George W. Bush was elected president in 2000. That's a myth. George lost the election. It was installed by the Supreme Court. They promoted the myth that George and Dick squeaked by in a close one and they were still in 2004. That's not what happened. We voted those bastards out in a landslide. They lost the 2004 election by nearly 10 million votes. The Las Vegas oddsmakers called it at 7:15 at night. They said there's no mathematical way that George and Dick can actually win with the votes that are in now. They're gone. We have a new administration. Well, we all went to sleep. After midnight, they just changed the vote totals in 11 states. The corporate criminals, masquerading as Republicans, in charge of our voting apparatus. So, America was psychologically raped in 2004. And then we were psychologically raped on September 11th. Americans think we were attacked by Al-Qaeda. That's not what happened. A demolition company was given the contract to destroy a bunch of old buildings in New York that had been losing money for 20 years. They couldn't figure out how to do it without getting sued for contaminating Manhattan, lower Manhattan, with asbestos dust. So by about 1998, there was a group of people said, we want to go to war in Iraq and Afghanistan and take over the oil fields. Well, the real estate brokers in New York, the owners of the trade centers, said, hey, let's demolish this whole group of buildings in broad daylight. We'll call it a terrorist event. And we'll have the media sell it, which they did. So we were told we were attacked by terrorists on 9/11, and three big buildings were destroyed in seconds. Two of them, the Twin Towers, went sideways in the wind as a cloud of dust. The myth of 9/11 is driving a lot of what's bad that's happening in America. America would be a different country. The last decade, the horror of the Bush administration would not have been possible without 9/11. As I mentioned earlier, in 1984, they paid a scientist to announce a fatal new virus that's causing all kinds of immune system disorders. So that Dr. Banks talked about it. She said the chemical companies put their heads together, AIDS, opium, diamonds, and empire. They selected a guy from the NIH, turned out to be Robert Gell, pay him stand up in front of a microphone and announce a fatal new virus that's causing all these kind of immune system destruction so that the chemical companies can't be sued for cancer and leukemia, toxic waste, all that kind of stuff. Is my 5 minutes up already?
No, you still got some time.
God, no.
Sit down. You're at 3 minutes, 51 seconds.
You shortchanged me on time in the past.
51 seconds?
Yeah.
Okay, so one more. I'll give you one more minute.
What I'm trying to talk about is that knowledge moves forward in the direction of truth. In just our lifetime, we, as the public, from the bottom up, we reached critical mass and said, it's not all right to have people lynched and hanging in trees anymore. That's wrong. We won't put up with it. Like the 5-year-old child she talked about that just jumped in, he said, this is wrong. I'm going to do what I can to fight it. Beneficial knowledge moves forward in the direction of truth on a wide variety of subjects. And that's happening all over the world. But you have to help people learn. It's what we call the Galileo learning curve.
Julian, right?
In Galileo's time, there was no phone, no internet, no television, no radio. The only way people could learn stuff is by talking to somebody. Walk over to their house, have a cup of coffee. There's tons of beneficial knowledge on a variety of subjects, and it's spreading from person to person in groups like this. And if we were a little more tolerant of trying to exchange information when we actually have a chance, when somebody is not standing by to say, well, I don't want to talk about that, so let's cut the time off. I'll say 20 seconds more.
Well, one more thing. I just want to say that, first, for the record, I am not a knowing conscious agent of the U.S. government.
This gentleman here had a question about heckling a minute ago. One of the things that happens here is that you try to cut people off when they're talking about stuff that is irritating or out of the realm of belief of one of the people in here. I would call for more tolerance in the future, and we would have a better exchange of information.
All right.
Thank you.
I would like to know whether more tolerance means giving more time to the speakers that promote Andy's theories than to other speakers.
I wanna.
In the first place, Don, you don't get to do that anymore.
All right, so it's my turn.
No,
it's my turn. My turn.
You get your own opinion. No, Charlie, you don't get to do this.
Okay. All right, my turn.
When I give you a list of facts,
wait, you don't get to talk.
All right, you need an arbiter here.
Your time is up.
All right, your time is up. Let's go on, guys. All right, let's see.
Let me finish, Charlie.
We've had this kind of heckling back and
forth for five years. This is not the. We're talking about race.
I want to address it right now.
No, I want to hear Andy. No, we got a topic tonight. These people came
here. Who wants to hear one last thought?
Let's hear one last thought.
I haven't heard a first one.
Please, Andy, sit down. I'm not here for you. Respect my right now. All right, I'm going to ask you.
He will respect mine.
Sit down. You had your chance.
Andy, if you don't sit down, I'm going to have to ask management to ask you to leave.
I'm trying to talk about multinational. All right, all right.
That's right. Throw them out when it don't go your way.
All right, guys. Settle down.
God, that sucks.
Settle down. All right. The issue has been raised.
I'm not going to put up a Don
Shea. And we discussed this many, many times. Who can you trust? The government?
Okay.
Or the multinational corporations, and it'll lose me that this is even a question, because the corporations, especially the multinational, have grown on a scale within our own lifetimes to equal or exceed the power of many of the governments, 190 some governments in the United Nations. I've often thought the only check on the multinational corporations was, in fact, the collective enterprise of the United Nations. These corporations come in and virtually take control of third world countries. And to even think for a moment that some of these corporations of Monsanto has any concerns for you is patently ridiculous and nonsensical beyond belief. They exist for one reason only, to make themselves rich. And they don't care if you live or you die, as long as they make profit. Now, the other thing to counter this is government. And hopefully that government will look out for your own interests. Watch out. They had a slogan for the Congress, the one. It was, watch out for the little guy. The one party had this slogan. Now, there are occasions, and we're going to cover this in upcoming topics, the speakers that are coming up, is do the corporations, can they buy the government? Everything is for sale, apparently, in a capitalist system. And yes, we're going to discuss this at length, and that's going to be the topic even more than one speaker, is the influence of money in politics. And that's the worst thing that can happen if the government takes the side of the free market capitalist against you. That's what happened in 1900, and it resulted in something called the progressive movement, because the government was taken over by these big shots. The tycoons like Ford and Rockefeller and so forth, against the little guy. And there were changes that came about, and they said, we haven't got a chance. I mean, they actually purchased the presidency of the United States. And that's not an opinion, that's a fact. And so you've got to watch out when government can be purchased. And the influence of money on politics is a nefarious thing, and I'm glad we're covering the topic. But anyhow, government, when it's on your side, is certainly beneficial. If it's on the side of some other guy, you know, it's just like I went into lobby in Congress on an issue, and the guy I was with, there was somebody came out of the office, and we didn't know the facts or not, but he turned to me and he said, Charlie, you know, that guy just gave the congressman a check for $50,000. And we come in there with some issue, oh, save the world, or something, you know. But that's the reality of the situation. Anyhow,
you guys behave yourself. Make up and play nice.
Okay.
That's no fun.
It's now my turn. If you don't mind.
Yeah.
Get up.
All right. Then well, we got some time here tonight.
Yeah, are you for capitalism, Timmy?
Actually, I am, Charlie. I'm a free market capitalist, and I love the system. The reason I like the system is that the market is not responsible for human deprivation or human degradation. It's a tool. It's a means of exchange. And it works whether you're doing it morally or immorally.
I'll be right back.
Now, that also means that nobody likes fraud, so you do need some form of regulation over corporations or over commerce. Part of it is, you know, be able to trust your money, be able, and like I said, nobody likes to see workers exploited. But I'm going to address another issue tonight, and that is the issue of Doomie. Well, to be honest with you, I'm a proud American. I like being done by our government. Why is that?
You can
well, what I'm saying is that being done in America is certainly better than being done in Syria, or being done from the former Soviet Union in Moscow, or even being done by some of these other foreign governments or companies. Don't forget, we were founded under a bunch of straight white guys who got together and said, hey, we're for liberty. We're for things. We made a lot of mistakes. We made a lot of mistakes. Slavery, the exploitation of black slave labor. But we've also made up for it. We had a civil war that settled that question, and the civil rights movement of the 1960s finally brought the blacks into full equality in this country. And there's still a lot that has to be done in order to bring that immigrant group into America's things. Because if you really look at it, the black race has only had maybe 30 years of real assimilation because they've only had that much time of equal rights and equal opportunity in our country. Like every other immigrant group, the Irish, the Catholics, the other immigrants from Europe or other countries have assimilated into this country. And we do have one of the best ways of bringing multicultural people together. I myself see America as a very great thing. And we've seen a lot of great things happen in this, and frankly, in this world in just the last few years. I myself have only been here a very limited time. I've seen, for example, South Africa, a guy who was in prison for 38 years. Become president of that country. I've seen the collapse of a despotic communistic system and the destruction of the former Soviet Union and a lot of other nations coming out of that and arising into an integrated Europe after two hard world wars. I've seen a communications revolution that has literally brought people together from all over the world. And I see America is still a land of opportunity, a place of hope, a place where people can get together and get things done. And if you have a little self-reliance, a little individualism, and some, you know, street smarts and a little luck, I think you can still make it in America. Maybe I'm old-fashioned, but I do believe in the value of work. I also believe in the value of volunteering your time when you have the chance and give back a little bit to this country. So maybe I might be done by the government and taxes, but you have forms of redress. Maybe I'm done by my employer, but, you know, he's making a profit and I'm keeping my job and I enjoy what I do. A lot of you people have genuine grievances against your employer. Well, thank God there's unions that countervail that power. But you can still be done here and be heard here. I would much rather be done by America than be done in Syria. Thank you.
Okay.
You've got the right to complain. That's nice. You've got the right to complain all you want.
Okay.
I feel better. It's all right.
Okay.
Need that advice.
First of all, Tim, when you spoke of white guys getting together for liberty, you have no idea how deeply gratified I was to hear you acknowledge that slavery was a mistake.
I am.
Yeah. That's number one. Number two, we don't always have unions to fight for us. For a long while, the Circuit Court of Cook County was without a union, either in the Chief Judge's office or in the Clerk's office. Especially in the Chief Judge's office, because it took a long while. I was there for nearly all of my 30 years before the Teamsters finally came in and got us all organized. Secondly, with regard to the time that Nelson Mandela served in prison, actually I think that was 27, not 38 years.
I think you're right, it was 27.
Yeah, I don't think he quite served his that much time. Second, with regard to the organization of the progressive movement, Henry Ford at that time in 1900 was only just getting his auto company off the ground. And he didn't have that much power then. His power didn't come about until the 19-teens, when he was, by that point, had introduced the Model T and had become the best-selling auto in the country. And he had priced it so that everybody could afford it. Unfortunately, he was not, his company was not always an easy place to work. He fought the unions tooth and nail until the 1940s when the United Auto Workers finally got in there. And I'm sure at least some of you have seen the photographs that were taken when Walter Reuther and Victor Frankenstein tried to pass out leaflets and were clobbered by some of Ford's union goons, or excuse me, anti-union goons that were under the control of Mr. Harry Bennett, who was in charge of security. They called it the Ford Service. So things haven't always been so hunky-dory here in this country. And as for trusting the government or trusting capitalism, or not capitalism, trusting business.
Good.
I trust business less than I trust the government. But that doesn't entirely mean I trust the government either, since all too often it is one and the same. It was not for nothing that in the last few weeks of the Eisenhower administration, just before President Eisenhower left office in 1961, when he delivered on television his famous farewell address, when he warned the American people of the dangers, whether sought or unsought, of a military-industrial complex. And the very thing that President Eisenhower was afraid of has come to pass. Finally, Sonja spoke of, you know, what we expect from this country and what we've done for this country. Well, I don't want to inflate my role in the court system any bigger than it was. I was only a cog in a machine. But still, for 30 years, I was one of the cogs that helped keep the court system running. And so what I want is that my pension should continue, and I should enjoy a reasonably tranquil retirement. Thank you.
All right. Yeah.
Pat Butler.
Pat Butler. Pat Butler. Previous speaker said that he would be happy to be done in America. I don't know about you, but I would rather be a made man than a done man. Now, I have no doubt for a moment that America is indeed a land of opportunities you're not going to find in too many other countries. But those opportunities come only when Americans work together, not against one another. The thing that I took out of this talk this evening was that we have got to stop thinking in terms of black, white, brown, or yellow, or green, and we have got to start working together, because the problems that our speaker tonight cited are the problems, as I said earlier, that a white guy or a brown guy or an Asian guy could face just as easily right here. Now, to some people, unions are a dirty word. I can only tell you, and I think reasonable people, if you really stop and think about it, will realize that the standard of living that we enjoy today, the fact that many people here have lived middle-class lives whose ancestors did not have that opportunity.
Barbara.
Because of those things, what made that possible? Unions. What made it possible were the guys who were, they were mentioned earlier, who were hanged on trumped-up evidence after the Haymarket disturbances. They were made possible by guys like my uncle, who got shot. He lived. The Pinkerton was afraid when, even after he had been shot, my uncle went after the guy. Because I do not come from a family weaned on the idea of passive resistance. Like most of us, I'm a citizen of a country which was born in revolution, which was born in revolution by people who weren't going to take it anymore. My ancestors came from a country where for 800 years they were ruled by outsiders. And those outsiders had been told time and time again, you've worn out your welcome, time to go home. Go home or we'll send you there. On other occasions they will say, have you not had enough room in England for your graves? Must you leave your bodies over here? Sometimes you have to bind together and use fairly loud methods to get people's attention. That doesn't make you a rabble-rouser. It doesn't make you a bandit. It doesn't make you a terrorist. Although I'm sure that George and his cronies, Lord North and others, would have considered George Washington to be the arch-terrorist. There is no doubt that George Washington, oh, incidentally, usually you're right on the money, but when you were talking about this country being founded by straight white men, you evidently have not read too much about Baron von Steuben.
I wasn't the one who said that.
Oh, it was me.
It was Tim.
I'm sorry, Tim. Tim. I'm sorry. But you're usually right on the money. But Baron von Steuben was white. But there's a lot of evidence to suggest that straight was not his persuasion. doesn't make him a bad person. But every time I watch the von Steuben Day parade up on the Northwest Side, I admire von Steuben. He is the guy that brought order and training and discipline to the American Army. But if people knew what his orientation was, there might have been some snickers years ago. I don't think that would be the case today.
Yeah.
We are a country made by a variety of people whose secret of success is that we have all worked together. I realize there are those who praise the rugged individualists who made it all happen. What made it all happen was a bunch of rugged individualists of every conceivable color, in every conceivable religious persuasion or none at all, working together toward a single goal. Sometimes it was to teach a lesson to the 1%. Sometimes it was to teach a lesson to people who thought that they were the master race. Sometimes it was to teach a lesson to moguls who thought they owned the government. And it became necessary for the people of this country periodically, usually at the polls, but not always, to take back that government. You mentioned that if you were a Catholic, you'd be going to hell. I can tell you, I'm a Catholic, and I suspect that that's where I'm going, too. But, so, you know, maybe you're better off as a Unitarian. Maybe they'll give you a pass. See, in this room, we got a variety of people from a variety of persuasions. We've got people who think the government set up 9/11 And we've got other people who think that Pearl Harbor was planned by Franklin Roosevelt. We've got other people who think Edmund Stanton engineered the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. And if I don't get up this podium, this guy is going to engineer my premature demise.
Okay. All right. All right. Who else wants to speak?
You got a second round coming?
We got time.
Andy?
All right. Tell you what.
Andy, we got time.
What about you, Andy? You want to have another 5 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
All right.
And Steuben wasn't gay.
Yeah.
Last week. He was flamboyant.
He was not.
He wore a hat like yours.
Were you on his staff?
That's cool.
Okay,
high
Andy.
For you,
you're set.
You're starting?
Yes.
I apologize for the earlier outburst. This is a free speech forum. I'm a little. I guess I'm a little overly critical sometimes. Well, I have trouble when I describe
so
to people. I'm a translator. I translate databases.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah,
so if I translated the database on the round versus flat Earth data, there's a Flat Earth Society in England. They have about 2,000 members. But the round Earth data is 99.9% certain. Once the database on something forensic evidence gets so big that it's almost, one side is really lopsided, like flat versus round. They used to debate that 800 years ago. Now we don't talk about the round earth theory, it's accepted as fact. We don't talk about the theory of cigarette smoking being harmful to your health in a variety of ways. That's accepted as fact today, where it was considered theory years ago. Well, when someone makes a comment, after you list forensic evidence, it's 3,000 scientists have worked on this, they published a database, I'm a little sensitive when somebody says, well, that's Andy's theory. What's in these books is not my theory. I'm simply translating a database of evidence produced by people that have worked their whole lives on this. There's a huge amount of data on a variety of subjects, and if the beneficial knowledge were more widely spread, for instance, the houses out in Schaumburg with no furnace that heat for $10 a month, there's hundreds of them. We don't need to be fighting for foreign oil in foreign countries, Afghanistan and Iraq. ComEd recently said they were going to shut down a couple of nuclear power plants because they're not competitive anymore. Well, they didn't tell us that the wind farms are generating cheap, green electricity, tons of it. Mm-hmm. Future belongs to solar and wind power. Environmentalists have been writing that for 30 years. At any rate, this book, The Betrayal of the American Dream, describes what's happened in the last 34 years. They said 100 million Americans are a group of a pioneer, a type of pioneer that's never been seen before in America. People that are heading down the economic ladder, out of the middle class. They're heading down the scale and it's harder and harder to survive, and they have no hope of getting back up to the standard of living where they were before. That's all the different pieces of what we were talking about tonight. A lot of it is related to the fact that the middle class is being eliminated in the United States by corporate America, who owns and operates people masquerading as our elected officials. So the knowledge starts from the ground up, and beneficial things happen when we reach critical mass. A bunch of people reached critical mass and told the Catholic Church, you don't get any more money if you don't do something about the pedophile priest problem. And so they're having to acknowledge that now. They covered that up for decades. So, things get better when we reach critical mass on almost anything. Barbara Ehrenreich, incidentally, wrote a book called Nickel and Dime, Surviving in America. I mean, some of you are familiar. This is her book called Bright Sided, and she makes the point that always looking on the bright side, positive thinking, in her quote, constant positive thinking obscures judgment and shields us from vital information. trying to always look on the bright side prevents us from seeing, as we teach seventh graders, you have to correctly identify the problem, and then you can correctly identify the solution. This is not brain surgery. You have to, as President, not President, but Professor Griffin, David Ray Griffin said about 9/11, he said, you don't need an open mind to understand this. You need a 30% open mind. Just open your mind 30% and look at the information with the knowledge that would be gained by seventh grade science class. It's easy to understand what happened, but you first have to step through the psychological barrier and look at the evidence. On every major problem in America that's been solved in the last 100 years, it's been by people, pioneers, stepping through the psychological barrier and looking at the evidence, and then other people come along behind them. And today, some of you may remember 30 years ago, you could get into a fist fight if you asked somebody to put out a cigarette smoking next to you in a restaurant at a counter. Today, we've accepted smoke-free buildings. It's an idea whose time has come. So that's all I'm trying to say, that once a database gets so big, it's no longer somebody's opinion. It's accepted as reality, forensic evidence. And
okay.
If we move forward and look at the evidence, we can solve a lot of problems. Okay? Thank you.
All right. Okay.
There's no
all
evidence.
Right, anybody,
I'm
all right. Anybody?
Most
we got. We got plenty of time. Anybody else want to speak?
Yeah.
No. All right. Well, I'll just give a very brief speech. Can you time me, Tim?
5 minutes.
Oh yeah, 5 minutes. Same as everybody else.
Okay, Don.
All right. First of all, our speaker posed a series of questions tonight to all of us, and now, normally I try to talk in more universal terms, but I'll try to answer her questions tonight. First of all, from my notes. First of all, the question she asked is, if you were a young black male back in, let's say, in 1955, and you were traveling through Bridgeport, would you be right to, and you saw a group of young white men, coming your way, would you be right to fear them? I think the answer would be yes. And I forget who it was. Was it Eugene that cited the book Boss?
I did.
No, you. It was you, Dave, who cited the book Boss by Mike Royko. He talks about this subject. And there were attacks on young black men and who happened to pass through Bridgeport on foot. As late as the last time I read a news report about it was in the late 1990s. So this isn't that all that long ago. Now, if you're black, would you be right to fear the cops in Mississippi in 1964? But the specific circumstances were pretty much, and you brought that up, Dave, it was the whole thing in Neshoba County with Mickey Schwerner and Dave, who was it?
Andy Goodman.
Andrew Goodman and James Chaney. That's right. And now the third question was, if you're black and you're traveling through Englewood today, would you be right? And you saw four young black men coming your way. Would you be right to fear them? Well, now I have to admit here that I'm probably just a little bit prejudiced because I actually would be afraid, right after I moved to Chicago when I was 9 years old, and I got, the first summer I moved to Chicago, I got mugged, I was living in the predominantly black section of Hyde Park, and I got mugged twice, both times by young black men, and so, yeah, I would be a little bit afraid of that, especially if it was four guys. One guy I wouldn't be afraid now, because I was littler when I was 9 years old, but I would be afraid of that. And as a matter of fact, I have a friend who lives down on the south side, much further south than Hyde Park, in what he tells me is he's a black man, and he tells me it's a kind of a rough neighborhood. And he's been menaced and mugged by, he's an older guy, he's like 40s, 50 or something, he's like my age. And he's been like insulted, threatened, and attacked and mugged by black men in his own neighborhood, where he lives 365 days a year. And he usually call him things like faggot, homo, stuff like that. I don't know whether he's gay or not. I
That's none of my business, frankly. But so yeah, those are there's, you know, neighborhoods like Englewood or Austin. Those are dangerous neighborhoods for anybody, whether you're white or black. Now there's the other question is, what have you done to make a difference? I like to think that in my current occupation that I am making a difference. I am an owner of a small business. It's called Hyde Park Tutoring, and we offer tutoring services to elementary, middle school, and high school students in all subjects. So I like to think that we're making America a better place one child at a time. And I also am involved in a number of political causes, including Citizens Taking Action, which Charlie is in as well. That's the group that campaigns for public transit. So I like to think I'm making a difference there too. In terms of what do I expect from America, I don't know if I expect anything except I wish the, I think people, what do people have? I think that we all have human rights, just by virtue of being a human being, that we all have rights. And I think that those rights have been pretty well enshrined in the Bill of Rights in our Constitution, and also in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And I think we do have a right to expect that our rights will be respected. Now, is it okay for corporations to arbitrate? I would be very hesitant about this. I see this as the privatization of courts, you know, a kind of what we think of as a public good, courts where people can come and settle disputes, where it's being taken over by corporations. So I would be very cautious about that. Who are your heroes? You got to be careful about heroes because especially when you've just been informed by our timekeeper here that your time is up. But I just want to say that nobody's perfect. So even the people you idolize as heroes, you'll find, are not really perfect. And okay, and with that, I will yield the floor to someone else.
My hero is General Von Steuben.
Give her the final say. Okay, anybody else rebutting? I'm going to let our speaker come up and have our final say tonight.
Okay.
Final say.
Let's thank our speaker again one more time.
Okay, let's have a round of applause.
The speaker's getting older. Let's thank General Von Steuben.
Don't worry. Plenty of time.
Checking the mic.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone. I think I've gained maybe more than you have. I think it's been a good experience. It's not normal for me to sit in a room with a majority of older white men and listen to anything that they have to say.
Were you frightened?
No, I'm not scared that easy. I'm a tough old girl. I don't scare that easy.
You're glad Mike Foley wasn't here.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he's crazy.
I can sit around and I can live my life and I can be in all kind of black meetings and we can talk about what the white man thinks. I got to sit up and listen to what he thinks. And I'm appreciative of that. There are no absolutes. They are not.
We're getting married.
We have our prejudices and our hates and our ideals and all of these things. And we live with this inside our crazy heads every day and thinking how right we are about this man. And I'm guilty. Don't be mistaken now. I'm guilty of it as well. And if you look at my book, I may not answer the tough questions, but you can pretty much sum up who I am and what I think by the questions that I ask. You can, if you look at it, because it came out of me, it came through me, and out of me. So I'm very thankful, number one, and yes, corporate takeover of courts is something that is very frightening, as far as I'm concerned. I've seen it in action. And as far as Tim, a bunch of straight white men, they the one was doing this, huh? I don't know. Mr. Anderson, you're going to have to help him with that. I don't know. I think he has the wrong idea about who came over here and started up some of this mess over here. But anyway, I think talking about rather be done in America than being done somewhere else, I can agree to most of that. I worked for Eduardo Zapata owned a mortgage company, and I worked for him in the like 2001, 2003, somewhere up in there. It was at Milwaukee and North Avenue over that way. And I was the only black in that company, maybe four whites. Everyone was a Latino from all over the world. People escaped out of Cuba, people came from, there were Brazilians, there were just people everywhere, people I've never met and talked to before. It's good to be in that type of environment. And I think I lost my thought as to what I was going to say about those people. Oh my goodness. I do know that he did fire, the manager was white, he fired her, she sued him for discriminate against white people. You know, things change. She lost the case. But I am very grateful and very thankful for being here tonight, and I appreciate it all. I sure want to remember what that point was, but you know what? I have lost it down all the way down the road. It was one other thing.
I'll think of it tomorrow.
I'll think of it when I sit down. It's not important, though. It's not important. Mr. Anderson and I are going to get together, and hopefully I can do some interviews with him and document some of the things that he's talking about. I think Ron and I, we did about 2 years of interviews. We had about 80,000 downloads on those interviews. So hopefully with some good titles and some good marketing, we could put some of this information out there that you want to share, and I look forward to it. Oh, getting done. Oh, I'd rather be done in America. Oh, this one guy that worked there, he was from Mexico, and he kept saying his father wanted him to come see him. My father wanted me to come back home down there to see him. My father, I don't feel like going. I don't want to go. They don't have toilets. He'd rather be done in America. You ask me what I like about America. I like toilet paper. You know, like bathrooms and toilet paper, I'm just sorry. I just don't want to go where they don't have bathrooms and toilet paper. I'm appreciative of a lot of things. And we have the right to be critical, and we have to be thankful for that right. And don't get that wrong
right.
at all. There's a lot of right and a lot of wrong. Done, past, now, and we'll continue on. But a new campaign, this is going to be my final word. I don't know if you gave me 5 minutes or not.
No, you can take as long, right? You can take as long as you want.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Take till 9 o'clock.
Oh, okay. One of my new campaigns coming up. And it came, if I may tell the story. This is what the name of the campaign is. I'm always starting. You just don't even know the little things that start. Google my name. I'm just crazy. I think we live to create. What's the use in keeping it all up in here somewhere? What you going to do with it? I mean, I got so many papers. I'm just dragging them around on my back. What you going to do with it all up in here inside of you? Bring it on out. Create something. Write something. Whatever it is that you're designing. I mean, that's what it is. What is it stuck all in here for and all up in here for? And so I make new products. I just make up stuff. He asked me what my business is. I can barely describe it. I just make up stuff to sell it. I sell tweets. I mean, I just sell. I said, oh, maybe I've seen something. I said, oh, maybe I could sell that. Hey, all of a sudden it's a product. It's in my credit processor. Hell, here we go out there. It's tweeting. It's on Facebook. I'm selling something this week. I'm selling something this week. That's what big people do. They do it all the time. They make up these businesses. They make up these things. You think they just what existed or they copied from somebody else? But I'm making up something else. Well, I have a whole list of like 5,000 things I'm making up. But anyway, that's why I can't get to my book. This came about, and I feel so bad. I do really feel bad. I'm starting a petition, and I will send it to you. I will not give a damn anymore, because I can't live like that. I sound like an extrovert and a network and everything, but an introvert. I like to be alone. I like to work. I really don't like people calling me on the internet, you know, Gmail person. But because I built the network over 4 years and was really doing events and that type of thing, well, I've really stopped. I met a lot of people, and I networked with a lot of people in Southside Chicago and up in there in Chicago. I know a lot of people. If you Google my name, I know a lot of people, and a lot of people know me. I don't know why I'm not making any money off of it. But anyway, marketing has got to get better. But anyway, this new campaign, it's going to be in the form of a petition to start. And I've written it out. I've written out the plan. I do these one-page part of these plans because I don't have time to write anymore because I'm doing so much. I will not give a damn anymore and complain about it. I can't do that anymore. I tell you why how that came about. McDonald's is on Pratt and Clark. I live on Pratt and Ashland, a block away. Go up there, give them a little coffee at the end of the day before I go home. Decaf is only a dollar. You know, I might spend $1.50. Sit there, have a coffee, go on home. I'm just not ready to go yet, you know. Work a little bit, do some vital things I may be thinking about. So that particular day, the weather broke just a little tiny bit. And I was walking. I was early that day. It's usually like 8:30 or 9:30. So I was early that day. It was like 5:30. So I'm walking up to the McDonald's, and I look in. There's a group of black teenagers, maybe 4 or 5. I said, oh, my goodness, they're back because the weather broke. So the McDonald's not as empty anymore. See, we black people prejudice get black people. Don't want to be bothered with some of them. Well, you know how teenagers, you don't want to be bothered with yours either. Wake up. So anyway, he's sleeping. You woke? Okay.
No, I'm not sleeping.
Oh, okay. So I said, oh, okay. So I went to sit in the front part away from there. The back part where they sit is a tall table with tall chairs. And there have been 2 bullet holes in there last summer. Somebody drove back. I went back in there, and there was 2 bullet holes. I had the nerve to sit there. I said, well, I guess they finished shooting. I'm going to sit here, you know. There were 2 bullet holes there. And also this past summer, when I was sitting in there, somebody got shot at the laundromat across the street. It looked like they're getting really efficient because they must have came in, cleaned up, and they looked like they was gone in 15 minutes. Like, yeah, this is normal now. I don't know what that was. They were just gone. So this particular day, this was in January, and it's in my little red book, January the 12th, the day that I went in there, the weather broke, I went. So I sat in the front part so I would not be bothered by them. I didn't want to hear all that cursing, all that nigga, nigga, this, that, blah, 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 blah. I didn't want to hear it. I just didn't feel like hearing it. I'm not that tolerant of it. Sit in the front, through a long bench. They back there good. So I'm doing my little thing, you know, you got a friend in there. Here they come. They're boosting back of me. So it was more of them, so they wanted to come sit in the booth. So they sat in back of me in a booth. They started filling up. So then it was about 8, 9, 10 of them. Can I get away from these people? See, black people act like that, too. I'm just letting you know how we do. But they were not that bad. They said the word nigga, I turned around and look at them real hard. And I guess they said, you know, we don't want to go outside in the cold. We're going to leave them alone. And they went on. They were just drinking pop and being teenagers in McDonald's. People hanging in McDonald's. They used to Burger King. These little places after school. That's what teenagers used to do. So they were sitting there. So then all of a sudden, and we were uncomfortable. They were doing that thing. I wasn't uncomfortable anymore. I was fine. Because you know we want our way everywhere. I like my way. You know. And that's why we have so many conflicts in public. I do believe we want our way. Yeah. That's why we have so many conflicts. Yeah. So they sit there, and they were doing that little thing. So all of a sudden, two of them were sitting on the long table. They had little stools there. They say, those are Latin Kings. And they started having a little discussion. They started having a little discussion about, yeah, he real high up in that. Yeah, that's so-and-so. So then there's a side door, and 3 people walked in the side door. And young Hispanic people, they walked in. They didn't look at them, but I'm being nosy, so I'm looking to see who's walking in the door. And it was 3 Hispanics, young woman on the phone. She dialed. I guess it was checking the place. Young Hispanic guy in the front, and then the last Hispanic guy, he turned and he looked at everything, and I'm turning, looking right at him, you know, because I'm wondering, you know, who is it? And I thought, because I wrote a piece of the story about this, he had on this yellow jacket, light yellow jacket, the brightest yellow I had ever seen in my whole entire life. And I'm saying, why would a criminal wear a bright yellow jacket? I mean, he doesn't want everybody to see him. I'm like, you can see that from the moon. What is he doing? I'm looking at him, what is he doing with that yellow jacket on? And I'm too stupid. And I'm going to say the word stupid to know I might be in danger. If he said these are Latin Kings, see, I wasn't thinking, I'm not thinking like they're a bunch of gangster disciples. I wouldn't think that they were gang leaders. I just thought they were young black people that get my damn nerve. My mind just say they gangs. My mind didn't say that to me when I looked at those black children. They didn't say that to me. It would have been 13, 14, 15-year-old black boys, and my mind just did not say they gangsters. Why? I just don't assume that. Am I supposed to assume that every time I see a black child? No, I'm not supposed to assume that. And I didn't. Maybe, does that make me stupid? No, I do not assume that of every black child. So they came in, he checked, they walked out the back door, which they have locked now. So they went on, me not having enough sense to say, well, you know, maybe you should leave, or maybe, you know, maybe it's time for you to go, you know. Still wasn't thinking. One thing, I'm going to go back. I'm busy. I got things to do. I'm drinking my coffee. I'm, right, you know, I'm doing my thing. So then the young man that was right there, he said, that's them in that red truck. Because I'm hearing what they say. I'm not so much paying attention, but I hear what they say. That's them in that red truck. And I said, and then somebody said, where, right there. That's the other guy pulling up. They regrouping.
Oh.
And so I'm like, what they doing? So I'm turning, and then somebody said, where they at? Where they at? They start saying, where they at? So then I want to know, where they at? Uh-huh. This is why I cannot not give a damn anymore. All of a sudden, it's like, this is the life that they live. It was like one, like everybody in this room, there was a signal, and you all got up at the same time and moved out the door. That's exactly what they did. I couldn't find my purse. I didn't know where my phone was. I had all these papers laying out here. I wanted to go too. My coat wasn't on. They had never taken their coats off. Maybe this is the life they live, and maybe they know when to signal. Maybe they know when to move. It's like, I'm still trying to figure out where they at. As was the young man who was placing the order. He was up there. Where they at? And I'm trying to figure out where they at? Not knowing that I don't care where they at. Maybe I should leave too. So they left. Nobody came in. And I still could not see the car because it was a wall blocking. I didn't have their view. They had a view of the whole street. I didn't have that view. And they left. And so I had time to collect. Finally found my purse. Finally found my phone. It wasn't in my purse where I always put it. I had stuck it in my pocket. I must have been using it. And so I was thinking maybe, because I had been trying to get the manager's attention. They just ringing up food. They don't know nothing. Ain't nothing going on. They just ringing up food over there. And so I looked at the little young manager. He done dyed his hair blue this week or gold this week. I said, you know what? I don't need to talk to him. I need to talk to somebody in corporate. Because talking to this little guy is not the person I should talk to. And so I looked around the restaurant. And I looked at the people in the restaurant. They were chatting. It was like everything was just going on. Like nothing in the world had just happened. Nobody was aware. And I said, that's how people get killed and say they don't know what happened. Because they don't know what happened. You know, it's something that actually happened. So that was on the 12th. So on the 16th, and I noted, and I was supposed to go home, send a message to corporate, telling them that you need to make your managers more aware of what's going on into the environment over there, you know. However you want to do it, when young black people come in with a whole group of teens, I don't care how you say it, but make them more aware and to watch what's going on. And I didn't do it. And that's what I call, I will not give a damn anymore. I don't know if it was not that I would not give a damn anymore. I just did not take the time. And if, when you give a damn, you do take the time. You do what's necessary to get it done. So then the next week, on like the 16th, I can't remember the exact date. I think it was the 16th in New City, they had blotter. In that blotter, which New City like to say black gangs and black disciples and Latinos, everybody black commits crime according to New City. You don't see the white man did anything in New City. But in that blotter, it said, like on the 16th, that in a red truck, they had arrested a Latin King. I guess he was shooting. He had almost ran into the police car. He had been drinking natural Milwaukee, some kind of cheap beer, which is water. And he had almost ran into the police car, and he was armed. Okay, he had shot at somebody, but he was chasing somebody. He almost ran into the police car, and they picked him up in a red truck or Jeep. So I figured they had him, you know. And he had said earlier that week, they had been seen chasing some black teenagers. And then they had pulled up to some black women down the street. They couldn't catch the teenagers and told them, we shoot bitches too. So that had been reported, and that was reported. So I figured the red truck, I said, well, they got them. I said, they must have picked up them guys in the red truck, so I don't have to worry about that anymore. I said, they got them. That's probably the part settled. The next week or so, here they go. Same thing. I do know from that night to 12, one of the young men, after the Latin Kings left out, he said, damn, we can't even sit at McDonald's anymore. The next week, there was a shootout at the McDonald's in the parking lot. One man killed, three critically injured. And I tell myself, I can't say reporting what I saw that night would have stopped it, but I just think it would have been a call to awareness some kind of way. I don't know if it made a difference in any way, but I just say from that point, and that's the reason for that, I cannot not give a damn anymore. I want to thank you, and I hope that you all, and I have a whole list of reasons and different things in that position that I'm going to put out. And I think that's what you do here, okay, isn't it? I want to thank you very much. I have finished, and I want to thank you for inviting me. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you. All right. Thank you.